بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين. Welcome again, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, to another one of our programs entitled Ramadan Reminders. And as we begin, I would like to greet you with the Islamic greeting of peace by saying Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May the peace, the blessings, and the mercy of Allah be with each and every one of you. During this blessed month of Ramadan, a very important thing that Muslims pay attention to is that of giving their zakat. And giving up the zakat is a very, very important duty of every single Muslim, especially those who have the necessary amount, which is called the nisab, to give the zakat. But this giving of the zakat, it brings us to a very important matter in the Sharia regarding our wealth, because the zakat is an ibadah, an act of worship that is connected to our wealth. And sometimes we do know that many people, they do not pay their zakat, and even those who pay their zakat, then they actually come about with many different strategies to avoid paying the amount that they're supposed to pay. What we must understand from the very, very beginning is that wealth itself is a great favor from Allah, and it has been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wealth is something which belongs to Allah. It came from Allah, and Allah is the true owner of wealth. All the wealth on the face of the earth will remain here, that is in the earth. It will remain here, and all the people on the face of the earth will go one by one back to Allah. So then where does it go to? Where does it stay? It comes from gold and silver and other minerals. They become the source of wealth. And in the absence of these things, wealth really has no value. So therefore, if people are using gold, then gold will remain. A man will die and leave it in the hands of another person. And then that person will one day die and leave the money or the wealth, the gold and silver, in the hands of another person. And then another person will inherit it, and the money will pass through different hands. And another person will inherit it. And then that person will die, and it will go on from one hand to the other. And then it goes to the people living on the face of the earth during the last days. And after that, when everybody goes back to Allah and they all die, the wealth remains here. So wealth goes back to Allah because it came from Allah. This is why we often say that beautiful ayah of the Quran, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. We and whatever we possess, they all belong to Allah. Inna means we all, meaning we all as human beings, and everything we have, these things all belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they came from Allah, and so they will return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this wealth that we have, we must never think that we are the true owners of the wealth. We will use it for a time. We will use it to fulfill our needs and necessities, and use it to enjoy life, and use it to achieve comfort in our life, and happiness and joy and luxury in our life. But after all, it remains. It will pass through the hands of people, and it will remain. And those people who earn it and achieve it, and they have a bulk of it, when they die, they will go back empty-handed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is left behind. And those who are able to work it and achieve much more, then they will die, and they will go back again empty-handed. And the world keeps on remaining behind until there is no one to inherit it and no one to take it and use it. It goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, to Allah belongs the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has placed the wealth on the earth before Adam alayhi salam was created. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the gold and the silver and the diamonds and every single thing. you know, the wealth in the earth, the wealth in the ocean also, Allah has placed that there so that man will benefit from it. But man should not benefit from it and then behave in a manner that they are the owners of it and they become stingy and they become greedy for it. It should not be like that. They should use it and pass it on to other people. So because of the fact that the wealth, the true owner of wealth is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has that right to tell us how to use this wealth. And He has given us certain injunctions and orders, commands regarding the wealth. From the wealth, He has made a law for us. And the law was given to the nations before us, the law of paying zakat. And zakat is not a tax, nor is it a fine or a punishment. Zakah itself is an act of ibadah and an act of worship. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us wealth and we show gratitude to Allah and worship Him through our wealth by giving part of it back unto Him via the poor and the needy. And this is why He has ordered us to give zakat. But generally speaking, we must understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He invites us and encourages us to give to the poor and the needy, to help each other, to help His religion. Why? Because again, as I said, Allah is the giver of wealth. He's the bestower of wealth. He has given it to man. And then from what He has given us, He is asking us to use it in this way and use it in that way and use it in the other way. On the face of the earth, there are those who have and there are those who do not have. But it must not happen that those who do not have, they will die in hunger and starvation. And those who have, they will continue to become rich and wealthy and grow richer and richer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked them to part with some of their wealth and give it to the poor and the needy and give it in such states and situations that need it, that need the help, that need the assistance. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regarding the rights of the poor and the needy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has Himself said, وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ. And in their wealth, the wealth of the well-to-do people, the wealth of the rich people, those who have, there is a right for the poor and the needy people, for those who ask and those who are deprived. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that when a man possesses wealth, and he owns wealth, and he is known to be a well-to-do person or a rich person, the rights of the poor, it is in his wealth. In other words, the poor man, the needy man, the one who is deprived of worldly goods and wealth, he also has a right in the wealth of the well-to-do people. And so this person has to take out that right and give it to another person. But as I was saying there, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged us to give from our wealth for different reasons and for different purposes. One, He has given us the law of zakat. We will come to that, the explanation of zakat. He has given us also the encouragement and has asked us to give sadaqat. Now, sadaqat are general charities that you can give charity to anybody. You know, you can give even besides giving the zakat. And sadaqat, you know, in this context, doesn't refer to zakat. It refers to general charities that every day you could take out a little bit of money, give it to the poor and the needy with the intention of sadaqah. And, you know, whether a person is a Muslim or not, you see a person needs help, you can take out some money and give him some sadaqah. You can always give something in sadaqah. If you're a farmer and you plant something, you can take out something and give it in sadaqah and give it in charity. And wherever you are, every day you go to the masjid or whenever you go on a Friday, you see people who are asking and people who are in different situations, you take out some money and you give it in sadaqah. That sadaqah, that is general charity. And that is beside zakat. Now, sadaqah is a very powerful thing. And it is a very, very effective tool against, you know, calamities and difficulties. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged us to give sadaqah, because sadaqah itself, it paves a good way for a person. You know, so therefore, if a person gives sadaqah, whatever hardships, difficulties and calamities may be coming towards him, then by giving sadaqah, it removes those difficulties. It removes the calamities. As-sadaqatu tutfi'u an-nar, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that the sadaqah, it outs down the fire. It actually extinguishes the fire. The fire of hell and even difficulties in this life and punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life. So sadaqah could be khayrat that people give, and also, you know, different forms of sadaqah. And beside that sadaqah, we have the sadaqatul fitr, which is given in Ramadan. Now, the sadaqatul fitr given in Ramadan, it is also known as zakatul fitr. This is also besides zakat that people give. And it is something that is given and compulsory in Ramadan. And a person has to give a certain amount on his own behalf, as long as he is earning, he's earning a livelihood, he has to give that amount in sadaqatul fitr. And if people depend upon him, like he has a wife and she is not working and she depends upon him, and he has children under his care and they all depend upon him, and they are not working, then he will have to pay on their behalf. Sadaqatul fitr, you know, sadaqatul fitr, he must give that sadaqatul fitr on his behalf, on behalf of the wife, on behalf of the children. If the wife is working, then she can give sadaqatul fitr on her behalf. The husband can still give. If any of the children, they are working, they can give sadaqatul fitr on their behalf, but the father can still give if he wants to. And it is a small sum. You know, it's the same as the fidya. It is that amount, which is about 3¾ pounds of wheat, given, if it is given in kind, in that manner, as it is mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it can also be given in cash. And if it is given in cash this year, the amount is $13 per person to give in sadaqatul fitr. So that is given in Ramadan, and especially it becomes compulsory and upon a person who has the necessary means to give, because it is a very small sum and it is highly rewarding. The person who has the means to give should give it, and the time it becomes compulsory is on the day of Eid. When the day of Eid has been declared and it has been announced, then it is essential that a person gives it on the day before performing the Eid Salat. So the normal thing is that people, while they are going to for the Eid Salat, Eid al-Fitr Salat, then they can, you know, give it to the poor and the needy people, and also they can give it to family members, relatives who are poor and needy, and they can also give it even before the day of Eid al-Fitr. They can give it to whoever collects it in the masjid, and they take charge of it in order to distribute it to the poor and the needy of the locality. So therefore, these are the different ways that a person can give the sadaqatul fitr. But sadaqah, it's a very important thing. And our giving sadaqah and khairat, goodness, it should not be confined to the month of Ramadan. But we should build a habit within ourselves to always give sadaqah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to give a lot of sadaqah. He used to encourage his wife to give a lot of sadaqah. A simple thing is that you're at home and a person passes by and they are asking for some help and some assistance. Give something to them to help them to remove their problems, and give it with the intention of sadaqah also. And whatever situations come up in front of you, that situations such that help is needed and assistance is needed, once it is something that is, you know, where there is a need, you know, and the people who are asking for that need to be fulfilled, they are actually poor and needy, then you can give your sadaqah to those people. You can give sadaqah to these people. Obviously, zakat is given only to Muslims, and zakat have certain specifications in it. So therefore, we have sadaqatul fitr, sadaqat is also called khairat, and also zakat. It is from the act of giving sadaqah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned to us in the Holy Quran that the people who are deprived and those who ask, they have a right in our wealth. that it is their right that we should help them. Subhanallah. It is their right that we should help them. So therefore, it means besides giving the zakat, whenever situations arise in front of us and there is a need to give and to help, we should not look at the fact that we have already given zakat, and because we have given zakat, we should not give again, and we should not help the poor and the needy again, or give to situations that require our help. No, because besides zakat, there is sadaqat that are mentioned in the Holy Quran. And it is mentioned in the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And sadaqat, as I said before, what it does in this life, and it brings a tremendous amount of blessings in the hereafter. So, as I said before, we should build it a habit to always give the sadaqah, give charity whenever the need comes up. And even our own, make it a practice that we practice often, you know, to always give sadaqah. Now, with respect to zakat, it is that form of sadaqah, because the word sadaqat is also used for zakat in the Quran. But it's not that general charity. There are specifications for that zakat. First of all, there is something called a nisab. Nisab means the minimum amount a person must have in order for zakat to become compulsory upon him. So zakat basically is upon those who can afford to give because they have the means and they have extras. They have the means to live with and to live by, and they have extras. And this is why it is called nisab, because it is, you know, it is of a certain amount that it is beyond the needs of a person. So therefore, a person, when he possesses a nisab, a certain amount of wealth, which is called a nisab, and originally it is 19.7 troy ounces of silver, you know, because they used to use the gold and silver coins, and zakah became compulsory first on the silver coins. So the nisab was already fixed on the silver coins, and it was already fixed on silver, you know, before it can be fixed on gold. Because silver was used more as the gold coins, the silver coins. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam fixed the amount of silver, which actually was the nisab that became the nisab of zakat at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when other wealth came about, he also fixed the nisab. So gold is separate from silver, and gold on its own has its nisab. Silver on its own has its nisab. So gold, when it has its nisab and it came about and it started to be used, you know, widely by all, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam fixed a nisab for that also. He fixed a nisab for that. And when you had other things coming about, like the, you know, the animals, the cows, the buffaloes, the goats, the sheep, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also fixed a nisab on each one of these things. So all these different wealth, all these different sources of wealth, or that which itself can constitute wealth and valuables, it has its own nisab. And silver also has its own nisab. And it has never been that when the gold nisab came about, the silver nisab disappeared and it no longer remained. No, those who had silver, they used the silver nisab. Those who had gold, they used the gold nisab. And it continued like that. And those who had buffaloes, they used the nisab for buffaloes. And those who had goats, they used the nisab for goats. And those who had, you know, sheep, they used the nisab for sheep. And those who had camels, and they used to rear camels, they used the nisab for camels. So you can't take one and apply it on the other. So therefore, it was not permissible to actually look at the fact that a man may have, he might be rearing animals, and he may have a lot of goats, you know, and he thinks that, let me look at the value of the nisab of the cows and put it on the goat. It never happened like that, because of the fact that each separate thing which constituted wealth and a valuable had its own nisab. So silver has its own nisab that has never been abrogated, and it remains until today. You know, and it comes to the point that, you know, where people who have gold, they use the gold nisab, those who have silver, they use the silver nisab. And it came to a time when, you know, many things came into Islam, and you know, people started to change the currencies, changed from the gold coins and silver coins to the paper money, and even before that, many different things it came to. So therefore, when it became into the form of the notes we have and the paper money and changed into different currencies, and people started to use paper money and they forgot about gold and silver, although it's supposed to be backed up by gold and silver, you know, the fuqaha looked at it and they actually gave the official fatwas and verdicts regarding how you use these things, and especially when a person has money, the paper money. So it's not now gold coin or it's not silver coin, but you have paper. You know, in order to establish what actually will be the zakat, then you will use it against that which reaches the nisab first. You will use it against that which reaches the nisab first from that which used to be used as currency. So since gold coins and silver coins were used as currencies, and the paper money now has come to replace those things, then it will be backed up against the silver. Which is the dirham, the silver, which was the form of currency. It cannot be backed up against animals, because animals still remain here. You know, animals, people still rear animals, buffaloes, cows, sheep, goats, etc. But it will be used against that. So therefore, when a person has that amount of money that is equivalent to 200 dirhams, or 19.7 troy ounces of silver, he is known to have the nisab, and zakat will become compulsory upon him. Similarly, if he has goods, which is known as stock of trade, and they reach a certain amount, which equals to that amount, which is equivalent to 19.7 troy ounces of silver, then zakah will become compulsory upon him. So therefore, this is just a little understanding, you know, on the concept of the nisab and what should be used, as the fuqaha have, you know, unanimously agreed that the nisab that is reached first. And because the silver is of a lower value than gold, anytime a person has money, his monies will always reach the silver first before that of gold. So this is why the silver nisab is always used as, you know, as it has been officially mentioned as the official fatwa given by the fuqaha and the jurist of the time before and even of this time. So with this, we'll close today's program, and inshallah we'll continue with this same topic tomorrow. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all our acts of ibadah and worship, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq and the strength and the health to continue to complete our duties given to us in the month of Ramadan. Wal akhir da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.